students. In these schools, when it's a question of stakeholders, our whole discussion is in the context of a corporate. But maybe entrepreneurs are not all corporates. They grow to be corporate. So therefore, it would be interesting for us to learn that how the stakeholder context happens in case of partnership firms or not-for-profit organization and so on. So with this approach, we would like to hold the panel discussions over here. Community is still not explored because our second important word is social responsibility, which possibly is taken as charity. But we are not introducing the community concept possibly in the stakeholder. Neither tourists nor practitioners are highly conscious of it. So to me, it appears that the first point for debate today should be, how do we define a stakeholder in these entrepreneurial firms? Right? Since NGO would come easily, possibly I would like to ask, let's say, Sanjay, that how would you be like to start? How do we define the stakeholders in these kind of firms? Sanjay.
I have little experience with NGOs, but
no, NGO is separate.
We have the expert. On the for-profit side, where I have most of my experience, I think the stakeholders in a cliched kind of definition are people who invest money or the initial founding team. They are the most important stakeholders for any new venture that gets started up. And again, coming back to the funding side, most of the time, if you solicit outside funds, your stakeholders come from outside. They would be your early angel investors, or then going forward, you may have Series A investors. So investors predominantly acquire the position of stakeholders, mostly. That has been the larger definition. But I think over years, people realize that the value that you can derive for these investors is a strong function of internal people within the organization. So employees also started getting involved and being labeled as either what you call intrapreneurs, or they were also being categorized as stakeholders. And the latest, what I understand now, is that they are also trying to include your customers in as stakeholders. But there is still a dilution, as I have said. So customers may not be that strong a stakeholder vis-a-vis people who invested money. So this is my take on what a stakeholder is in the current system. Yeah, would you like to add something?
So when we start, I started like 2 years, 3 years back. I left my job like 4 years back. So when we start, lot of support also comes from friends and family, and my parents supported initially, and lot of money which goes in initially is our parents' money also. And in those times, we don't give them any equity. But personally speaking, I also consider them or my friends who actually helped me start. And also, the stakeholders. So, honestly speaking, whatever progress I make, I make sure that I also tell, my friends and family, what's the progress, because I think they are also one of the stakeholders. Apart from that, investors, mentors, anyone who technically gets the equity becomes a stakeholder, which Sanjay anyways has pointed out very well.
So, as has been rightly positioned by the people who have got a hands-on experience, stakeholders, the definition as such is rather a wide definition. So, theoretically speaking, anybody who has a stake in that particular business becomes a stakeholder. So, be it, as it has been covered, early investors, founding members, employees, customers, the family members who have supported you, the mentors. I would just like to add another parameter to this. Now, any new entrepreneurship venture, or for that matter, any new venture whatsoever, which comes out as a result of a dream or a passion, you have started it, you have started the first step of the journey, you take it forward, and as the
our stakeholders might differ, you know, when once you start up, where you know Ravi and you know pointed out, when once you start up, there might be two types of stakeholders who invest monetarily in you and your business and your idea, and second who is emotionally, morally, and to me I would say the one who has invested time in me, you know, as a mentor. They are the stakeholders. So it's very difficult to say, you know, this is my only stakeholder. Customers, obviously, I would say in a company like Airtel where we work, our key stakeholder is our partners, the big partners, the big vendors who work with us. You are dependent on them. I'm sure, you know, I don't have that much expertise on the non-profit side, but the government would also be a key stakeholder in lot of, you know, decisions which you make, which you, you know, have over the period of your starting up to making a successful company. So there are different types of stakeholders at different stages of your company. This is what I think.
So this was possibly for-profit kind of a picture.
Yeah.
Let's travel to the not-for-profit picture and Mr. Diwakar here.
I think this is a personal transition. But past 31 years I'm in this development sector. It's not purely non-profit. I can say it's kind of a transitioning development profession where stakeholding is dramatically changing. Earlier we used to have a consumer, or typical example is our microfinance industry, where stakeholding, it depends upon whom you talk to. And miserable mistakes have been done in defining, identifying the stakeholder. Strong brand loyalty, for example. When we were non-profit microfinance, we had very strong identification with our micro borrowers. So the definition was different. When we went to high voltage game, and what we have tripped in, it's an honest mistake. It's not that we have done deliberate or any criminal mistake. It's an honest mistake out of ignorance, or maybe out of speed, acceleration. And we have tripped in. For simple example of brand equity. The women whom have given 27 cycles of loans. Cycle means you have taken loan and repaid, that's one cycle. 27 cycles, imagine, it takes maybe 8 years to 10 years. And that woman is simply telling, I need not pay because some politician has told he will wave off when he comes. So who is at fault? Is she or is she? Is the stakeholding mistake that we have to question? Here the question is how you strongly identify your stakeholder or define your stakeholder, draw your lines. It depends upon, and it's very, very important, including the tertiary peripheral stakeholders like government. For example, simple Right to Education Act, you might have heard about it. There is a Right to Education Act. Government has a very funny act. I don't know whether this is forum to share. The education officer's income has doubled after the implementation of this act. And I am the victim. We are running Bodhi schools. And if bus gets punctured, they charge 8,000 rupees penalty. School bus. And this Right to Education Act, it's not a mistake of government, or I don't say that government is wrong or government is bad. It's a mistake of identification of their stake. Government has, state has its stake in education. That's why they have promulgated this act. And the disconnect, because you are very enthusiastic entrepreneur and you have started, and the disconnect makes you to ignore the stakeholding equations, which brings a lot of problems, a lot of disappointment. And these are all I call it political landmines. You have to treat cautiously. That's my definition of stakeholding. Depends upon whom you talk to.
In a layman term, we call people who have the skin in the game.
Mm-hmm. Unless you have a skin in the game, you don't have any skin. And coming back to your earlier categorization of internal external also, it is slightly harsh to classify in a very strong kind of black and white kind of camp. So, and I remember when we started off, the classical definition of an organization was that an organization is an entity which has a boundary. That is what people started off with. If you look at how a definition of an organization is in the current context, it's blurred. The defense is no longer sacrosanct. You break it sometimes and you go outside. Ankur rightly said that maybe your external partners become very important in the delivery of your products and services. So I may not totally agree with the hard classification of internal and external.
Yeah, so for me also, you know, the definition, we don't understand the definition, but how we go about, you know, from my experience of you know, having like 15, 16 investors, I don't remember how many investors we have, but, you know, there are so many angel investors that, you know, so internal, external, we actually don't define in terms of definition, but what we actually do is we define them as active and inactive investors, or active stakeholders who basically understand your business, who basically understand your problem. So you kind of, you know, interact more with them and you know, so that because they also understand your problems. But there are some inactive investors also, you know, who have just invested and they would like to just see the progress report. So that is the kind of definition we have, and the most important stakeholders are definitely your customers or your business partners. Because ultimately, you know, it's up to us, you know, how we actually treat them, and that's the most important part. You know, internal stakeholders who have already put in money or have skin in the game, you know, they will be benefited by the results of what is happening. But what is happening on a day-to-day basis is our relationship with the external stakeholders, if we define it in those terms.
I think NGOs works.
No, we need to thank Kalpana also. So.
We'll break for lunch now and we'll gather again. In the auditorium, there will be the next big venture, the B-Plan contest for the students. We also have two more events that will be conducted simultaneously. The event of which will be conducted in the new block, Attack Block G1, and the case management at G2. So we hope to see you all after the lunch. Thank you.